educator for about 10 years in New York City public schools. I taught mostly elementary school, and then I was an academic coach and a recruiter also. So I am here to help you with the demo lesson, which I hope you're familiar with. Does anybody know what a demo lesson is? Or want to explain it? Go ahead.
Yeah. I believe it was what the employer's axiom, the principal asks you to do in order to land a job.
Right. It's sort of like an audition for a job, right? So you go through the interview process, and then you you go through the interview process, and then they ask you to basically come in and do a demonstration lesson, which is you are teaching. Sorry, I'm just getting through this. You're basically teaching a lesson to a group of students that you've never met before. This could be, I've seen as small as like six students, whoever they can gather together. Sometimes it's at the end of the day and they don't have a full class. Or as many as like 32, which is a little bit intimidating. But these are, again, students that you've never met before, and you're asked to come in and teach a lesson while the administrators of that school come and watch you and evaluate you. Does that sound terrifying?
Yeah.
Yeah. It is, but I'm going to help you out. Don't worry. So those are the basics. So think about, given what I just told you about what a demo lesson is, what do you think might be some of the challenges? Just take a minute and maybe just write down a few ideas, and then we'll share them out. It's the first question in the pack. Ever hear that? That will definitely be a challenge. What else?
Finding a lesson that's like appropriate depending on their ability, because you don't know their ability.
Absolutely. What else?
IEP students, students that come in because of inclusion. They might not be a part of the class, but they come in for that period.
Just getting like comfortable with the students, knowing how you can act and like how you can talk to them. Because some students react differently to different tones.
Mm-hmm. And it's really difficult to establish a rapport that quickly, right? Anything else? So the great thing is everything that we just talked about, we're gonna address today. So don't worry, I'm gonna talk about exactly how to address. I've seen many, many, many demonstration lessons, some that were terrible, some that were okay, and some that were great. And I'll tell you that even if you have a terrible demo lesson that's not the way that you planned it at all, you can still get the job. And we're going to talk about that. And we're also going to talk about how to prevent it from being terrible. So just norms for tonight. Just keep doing what you're doing. Participate as much as you can. This is to help you. So the more you participate, the better it will be, and the bigger your chances are of getting the job. And then for some of the segments, I'm going to have a timer. So just when you hear the timer, just and if you have questions, just try to save them until the end of each slide. So the next section is about pre-planning for your demo. So this is before, when you know that you have a demo, when the school has called you and asked you to come in for a demo, but before you've actually started planning the lesson. These are some basic do's and don'ts. Okay, they should provide you with this information, but just in case they don't, the things that they might forget are this and this. So the number of students, the grade, the subject, the time and the place, that's all stuff that they'll provide you with, and they won't forget about that, chances are. The duration, by the way, I forgot to mention this in the beginning, you could have as little as 15 minutes for a demo lesson. I've seen it. You could have as much as an hour. But which is pretty unusual. It's the standard is really about a half hour. The technology, you want to ask, if you're going to be using any kind of technology whatsoever, you want to ask and make sure that they have the hookups that you need. And then also prep time. This is something that you probably won't ask, or most teachers don't ask, and this will help you a ton. So what I mean by that is, are you going to be walking into a class like this where everybody's sitting there ready for you to start? Or is it going to be a situation where you have 10 minutes before to put up your charts, right? Or to get all your materials ready, and then the kids come in? Why do you think that makes such a big difference?
Because if, oh, sorry.
Oh, no, you go first.
If you don't have enough time, you're already flustered and freaking out even before you begin.
And you do not want to start your demo lesson already flustered. It's really hard to recover from that. Anything else?
I was going to say, like, if the student's already here and you're putting up your chart now, they're probably losing focus and want to have a conversation with each other.
Exactly.
And it'd be even hard to, like, gain their focus again.
Exactly. And also, it's vulnerable. We'll talk about this in a second, but you're making yourself vulnerable. When you're turning your back to them and you're putting up charts, you're gathering up materials, or you're distributing things, you're vulnerable, right? They can be talking to each other, they can be getting into arguments. You're not in control because you're still doing things. So you just want to ask the question, just so you can mentally prepare. You can do it if you want to. I found that this is kind of a nuisance to HR people generally, or leadership. They're busy, busy, busy people. If you're emailing them, asking, like, how many IEPs? What are the IEPs for? Can you give me a class list? They're like, on the other end, they're not saying, thorough educator. They're like, oh. And also, right, and if you come up, you're going to come in with all your 28 name tags. You're going to spell the names wrong. The kids are going to be like, oh, I'm Jaden with a Y. Like, oh, no, that's it. They're going to take the wrong name tag. It's a mess. Don't worry about all that. You only have a half hour. You don't need the names of students. You don't need to know the curriculum that they're using unless you think it's really relevant. Standalone lesson. Do you know what a standalone lesson is? Or do you want to guess? It's basically a lesson that you can walk in and teach, that you don't have to have a lot of background information about. So it's always nice when somebody comes in and they're like, we know that you're learning about main idea, so I planned a main idea lesson. But you don't want to get too into it to the point where it's dependent, the success of the lesson is dependent on them knowing something that they should have known before, if that makes sense. So plan it so that it's something you could just walk in and teach that day, as much as possible. Also, this is another just little tip, but if they ask you what grade level you prefer, or what time of the day you'd prefer, tell them. You don't have to, don't try to be super accommodating to prove that you're flexible. Just tell them you're new teachers. Like you need that this help, right? So if they say what time of the day, morning time, they're crazy in the afternoon. Do morning time, and if they say what grade level, say what grade level you have experience teaching. Something that you're comfortable doing. I forgot to just show of hands. Who has been in classrooms before? Okay, and you're juniors, seniors, so you're still student teaching, right?
Yeah.
Has anybody never been in a...
They're all PE majors.
Right, okay.
So they're in the gym. So.
Awesome. Okay, so that will definitely... I'll have to keep that in mind when we're talking about a demo lesson, but they're all the same anyway. They have the same basic components. So, has anybody never been in a classroom before? I mean, obviously, in your life, but as a teacher or a student teacher? Okay, good. Another thing that you want to do is you want to plan around your strengths. This is super... It's funny because it's kind of obvious, but you get nervous and you just forget about this. Think about the reason that you became a teacher, right? There's something that you're really good at. Maybe it's that you're really engaging. Maybe it's that you can relate to kids. Maybe you have, you tell funny stories. Maybe I'm just putting things out there. Whatever it is, make sure you build that into your lesson so that they can see that best part of you and they can see you shine. So just take a second and just think about what your strengths are as an educator or as a person. Something that you would really want them to see. And you can write it down. If you have more. more than one, even better. Let's have two people share what their strengths are. This is always the part where people are shyest. It's funny. Okay.
Patience. I have
Ooh.
A lot of patience.
Good. That is a great strength when you're a teacher.
Yeah.
It actually took me a while to get patience. I was more impatient in the beginning.
Mm.
Anyone else?
I was gonna say like my happiness and friendly nature.
Good. That's a great point because one of my strengths when I went into teaching was that I thought I was really engaging and really friendly and positive. And when I planned my first demo lesson, I was so nervous that I forgot about that. So I went up there and I was like a robot trying to remember exactly how my lesson was gonna go. During the debrief, the principal actually told me, she was like, it's not evident that you actually like children. And I was heartbroken. But my point being that don't forget about that. Whatever you're, obviously I was heartbroken. Don't forget about whatever that strength is. Just make sure that you're letting it shine and you're remembering who you are as an educator. Yeah, I was really proud of myself for that. Okay, this is an acronym that I created just to help you remember what to do during your demo lesson or how to plan it. So you can either bring, I know that you were asked to bring a standalone lesson. I think you were, right?
Yeah.
If you don't have one, I can give you one, but it's not, it's like a first grade reading lesson. Do you want it? I'll pass it around for anybody who wants it. Raise your hand if you do have a lesson. Okay, that's probably better. If you don't, just take a minute and, actually either way, just take a minute and read through your lesson. Just so that you can... Another option is that you could remember a lesson that you have done in the past. That might be another way to do it. It's really for you, so whatever is most helpful to you. Thank you. that done?
Yeah.
Okay. So we're going to use this lesson just to answer some questions and plan. Okay, the acronym is POISE. So the P is for prepared. Be overly prepared for your demo lesson. Meaning, this is one that I feel like, especially new educators, forget about. Plan your routines. So, and I don't know very much about physical science. This is actually an area that, this is one of my growth areas. So you can, it would actually be really helpful if you gave me some examples. But if you, for example, wanted them all to get into a line, let's say, how are you going to do that? Right? So you could say, if you think that you're going to say to a bunch of first graders, everybody get into a line and they're all going to get into a line. No, it's not going to happen, right? You have to teach them how to do that. You have to model it. You have to say it in a very specific way. You have to maybe try it a few times. There's going to be five kids that don't even hear you. They're going to be off, you know, doing something else. So whatever the routine is, whether they're getting into a line, getting into a circle, what's something else that they might do?
Break up into different groups.
Break up into groups? That's a perfect one. That could be a hot mess if it's not done correctly. If you tell them, just get into groups of six, and they're third graders, just give me chills just thinking about it, right? So whatever the routine is, whatever the directions are that you're giving the kids, think about it in advance, and think about how you're going to explain it to them, and how you're going to show it to them, okay? Is that something anybody's had experience doing yet? Whether negative or positive, you want to share?
What, getting them into...
Yeah, any kind of just...
Okay, well, let's say there are two lines in the gym, like a red line and a black line. We'll say, if you are a girl, please go to the red line, sit crisscross. If you are a boy, please go to the black line and sit crisscross on the line.
Got it. Okay. What else?
I was doing, for a band, I was doing stations, and I had them rotate themselves, and it was just a mess. Because they couldn't go from move 10 feet to a different station.
So oh, yeah.
Next time I had to physically take one group at a time and change
them. How old were they?
Second grade.
Mm-hmm. Sounds about right. But you know what's good about things being a mess is that you learn from them. I'm telling you, I've had more messes than not messes. But the important thing is afterwards you just reflect on it. You're like, okay, what are we going to do tomorrow? And then sometimes it's a mess again. And then it's like, what are we going to do again tomorrow, right? And you were going to say something.
You could label, like, if you're doing a station, you could label them by color.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, you five, like, count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You five go behind the blue cone. And then, like, when you rotate, it's like blue goes to red. Red goes to green. Green to purple.
Yeah. Anything with colors or numbers is going to be huge for you guys. Anything else?
Our gym floor have squares and circles.
Mm-hmm.
So, we usually use the square as, like, a meeting area. So, like, everyone... go to the meeting area, sit down, crisscross.
They'll
understand the gist of it.
Good. So you're going to have to think about, in terms of a demo lesson, you're going to have to think in terms of what am I going to bring that's going to help them with this routine, right? Because you don't know if they have red or black lines. You don't know if they have triangles or squares. So you might have to actually bring something that you're going to hand to them or hold up or bring up signs to hold up to them. Are you picking up what I'm putting down here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This is an obvious one. That's something that you can do very easily. Okay, so this is gonna be tricky. And I don't know, for physical science, I always say to all teachers, bring all materials for the lesson, like bring pencils, bring whiteboard markers, bring erasers. This might be tricky for you because if you're actually using something like balls, you're not going to bring like a huge bag of balls in the subway. So I'm guessing that doesn't apply in this case. You'd have to ask them what they have. Or you could do something that does not require materials like that, right? So what's an example of something that you might do that doesn't require materials?
Think about like cooperative games, right? Something that you're not going to need to use a lot of things.
Back to the lines. Use the lines to play this game called Pac-Man.
Mm-hmm.
They stay on the line, they can't come off the line, you tax them and sit down. And kids who are sitting down come like help out the Tigers. So you could, you know, use your space.
That makes a lot of sense. You don't know if, I mean, you're going to assume that you're going to be in a gym, right? And double check with them, because honestly, guys, you never know. You might get there and they might say, like, a lot of these schools are really disorganized. And also sometimes things are beyond their control. You might get there and they might say, like, oh, we didn't realize the middle school was using the gym, so we're actually going to put you in a classroom. Just be ready for the worst thing to happen, okay? And just have in your mind, just in case we're not in a gym or just in case we're in a different space, just have a plan for it. If you do need pencils or anything like that, just make sure you bring everything. Don't assume that they have anything. For this particular, I actually want to skip this question because I don't think it applies to you, if that's okay. I don't think it's really, I mean, if you were going to do it for your own lesson, is anyone doing this for their own lesson? They bring their own lesson, they want to plan it? Okay, because I was going to, you know, I don't feel like it's really applicable. Okay, the O is for objective. Whatever your objective is, it should obviously align with grade level standards. And you know, have they done a lot of planning around objectives?
Yeah.
Okay. I know when I was in school, that was all we did, and I was so sick of it by the end of the program.
They've been doing a lot of lesson planning.
Good.
So,
okay. It's very important, but it was my least favorite part of teaching, I'm not going to lie. Lesson planning is not my favorite. Whatever the assessment piece is, also should align directly with the objective. So however you're assessing whether or not there's mastery, obviously it should align with the objective. This is just a bonus. If you can, have the objective or the agenda is even better, visible to the students. That's huge. Think about how, like, I'm here right now, you're like, well, how long is this? There's all these thoughts running through your head. You're like, how long is this gonna be? Like, do we have a break? Are we gonna be doing stuff? Are we gonna be working in groups? Just seeing the agenda sort of calms you down and makes you feel a little bit more secure. Especially if they don't know you. They've never met you before. A lot of them are probably terrified. They're like, what is this guy going to make me do? Like, what? Is this person crazy? Are they going to make us partner up? Like, okay, so question number four is... what are the different ways that you can assess during and throughout the lesson for understanding? Do you know what I mean by that?
Ask students questions.
Sorry?
Ask students questions.
During closure, you got the students.
Say it again, sorry.
During your closing,
mm-hmm.
you got the students come up and give a demonstration of, hey, how do you. What are the cues of throwing, or what are the cues of catching? Or what we do basically is scan, make sure, like, okay, this kid's
scan.
Scan the floor, the gym, and you know, we check them off mentally.
Mm-hmm. Even better, especially, and this is, I've seen some really great demos where teachers have done this. Instead of scanning them mentally, actually have a clipboard and check it off as you're looking around. It's super easy to do. You just look around and like it's either X or it's a check. And then that way, we'll talk about the debrief afterwards, you can actually discuss some of the things that you saw. And then obviously the leadership team is seeing that you're gonna follow through, right? And you're paying attention.
Would that be kind of difficult if you don't know the kids and the kids' names?
Yes. So with this, I feel like I'm just picturing being in a gym. I almost want to take back my name tag thing. Because being in a gym, you don't have the option of having name tags, right? Which is something that I like sometimes will tell people to do, just have them jot down their names. You obviously don't have that option. I would almost say maybe you should do name tags, but just give them and have them write their names themselves. So you don't have to do it in advance. Because if you do it in advance, it's going to be tricky. It might be a different class. So maybe just take 5 minutes in the beginning, or less than 5 minutes, and have them just jot their names super quickly, set a timer, so that it doesn't take too long. Does that make sense? All right, what are the other ways that you can assess during the lesson?
So volunteer, they're performing the proper technique of the skill you're doing.
How?
So if I said, you're throwing a football, you want your arm like an L, you want to step, twist, and throw, see if they're performing that motion properly,
mm-hmm.
as you said.
So just observing.
And maybe at the end of class, like if the students are in groups of pairs, have them speak for a minute to each other and ask them to, like, have each someone from each group like participate and discuss like what they discussed, like
mm-hmm.
how they learned and stuff.
Okay, what else?
You can have them do pair assessment.
Mm-hmm. Tell me more about that.
We have them, like, if they're in groups, you can have them have partners and see what they're doing wrong and see if they can give their partner feedback, corrective feedback, like, hey, it's not like this, it's you're not putting your arm right or whatever.
If you're going to do that, I actually really like that idea because it makes it easier. It's hard for you to assess 27 kids and whether they're throwing correctly, right? I think what would be even better is if you actually gave them a checklist that had like the four things. I'm saying throwing properly because that's the example that you use. I literally could not tell you four things that you need to throw properly. Couldn't tell you one thing. But think about what those four things are. Can you, wait, maybe you can tell us. Like what? What's an example of what you might have on a checklist to show that they're throwing properly?
Arms in the L.
Okay, that's one.
Sideways towards your target.
Okay.
Step twist and throw with your body.
Mm-hmm.
Your other hand you could use to aim, help you aim where you're throwing.
Okay.
Eyes on your target.
Okay. So if that's what you're teaching them and that's what you're assessing, then maybe they sit with their partner, they watch their partner do it, and then they just check them off. Or maybe they can make notes and say, like, this is what he needs to work on. And then you can collect those checklists. Does that make sense? And then you actually have something physical to look at. I is for interesting. So try to put your, this is another thing, it seems super obvious, but this is, a lot of teachers forget this because they're nervous. Put yourself in their shoes and just think, like, would I want to be here if I was this student? How are you going to, they don't know you, right? How are you going to make this interesting and engaging for them? And you don't have to be, do it in a way that feels naturally to you. So don't try to be, if you're not like a happy-go-lucky cheerleading type, then don't be a happy-go-lucky cheerleading type. Just do what feels authentic to you and show how you build relationships with students. This is another thing. I know that this is all the rage right now in education, so I probably don't have to go too much into it, but the students should be doing something most of the time. And we forget, I mean, you're seeing that I talk so much, and I do it all the time. We forget that people aren't learning when you're talking. They might be listening, but they're not actually really learning anything until they try something. So the students should be doing most of the time. You've talked about that, right, probably? So what are ways that you can do that? Like, how can you make it so that you're, the majority of the time that you're, during your demo lesson, the students are doing rather than you explaining or modeling?
I have the students doing.
Mm-hmm.
Have them demonstrating.
Mm-hmm. You can do that gradual release model. Have you done that yet? Studied that? Right. So, like, you show them how to throw. You have one student that comes up. Maybe you evaluate and talk about whether or not they did it. And then a group of students, right? And then everybody's doing it.
Creating visuals, too, for them, too. You could have it already set up with the cues that you want for the specific skill. And they could practice it one by one so that they're actually doing it, too. Instead of you just saying, this is how you do it.
Right.
To have them watch.
Mm-hmm. Using a hook, this is huge. If you can find a way to hook them in right at the beginning, even just a simple question, who saw the Giants win the other night? Right? All of a sudden, even if you don't like the Giants, which, like, I could care less about the Giants, I'm listening. And I did not watch the game. I should have watched. It was, like, the only time they ever won. But sorry. But you know what I mean? Like, it gets people all of a sudden are listening because you ask them a question about their life. So any kind of hook that you can use to draw them in the beginning is a bonus. Anyone have any other good hooks? Anything they've ever tried?
Like in football, I have flag football lesson, and I would mention about like the Sunday night football, and
mm-hmm.
seeing it.
Yeah.
Say, oh, these players, professionals can throw like four times school yard, try to get them, you know, motivated and excited.
Definitely.
That's a good one.
Okay, so question number five is about making your lesson interesting. So just think about how you can do that. And just take maybe a minute and write down some ideas. Think about what you wanted to see. Is everybody, is this K through 12? Is it K through 12? Okay. So that's so tricky because you have to think about like what's interesting to a first grader is not interesting to a 10th grader, right? But maybe just as many ideas as you can think of what, how you can make this interesting. Let's have five, let's see if we can do five shares.
Include a reward or slash prize.
Sorry, what?
Include a reward or prize.
Oh, that's huge.
Use the music.
Music, definitely.
Include competitive activity.
Absolutely.
Have the students like work towards something or like prize or like a point system?
Mm-hmm. Some kind of goal. What else?
I said the holidays.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Everybody loves the holidays.
Yeah, yeah.
Except
like
adults.
Halloween, we did the Halloween games, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Anything else? I really like the music idea. I think that's huge. I mean, everybody, think about it. I sometimes with my workshop, they'll play like a song or a video clip. You should see the way people's faces are like, thank you. We're so sick of hearing you talk. It's just such a nice break. It gives everybody a minute to just like relax for a second. I don't know why it's so powerful, but it is. Okay, this is another huge one. The number one mistake, you're all undergrads, right? This is what you're going to do wrong, I'm telling you right now, because this is what everybody does wrong when they have less than 3 years experience. They overplan, and they end up, you're half hour into your lesson, and you haven't even started, like the students haven't even begun to play whatever it is they're supposed to be doing. So you're going to have to cut it down. Just plan your lesson as if, just think about it as if it's half the time that it is, because it goes by like that. So you're most likely going to have to cut it down. That's the first thing. You only have 15 to 45 minutes. A lot of times principals or whoever's watching your demo lesson, they'll actually stop you. So if you've gotten to the point you just explained to them how to play the game and, you know, you were dealing with some behavior issues or whatever and it took a little bit longer than you thought, and then your 30 minutes is up, your 30 minutes is up. They might just stop you and say, okay, let's go have the debrief. So don't get thrown off if that happens, because that doesn't necessarily mean that they don't like you, just they have, it's time sensitive, right? They have stuff to do. So just keep that in mind. Students should know what they're learning and why they're learning it, which is kind of tricky. This is definitely something that I worked on even towards the end of teaching. The why behind everything, right? I actually had a principal that I worked with that used to go around during demo lessons and ask kids, she'd be like, what are you learning about? Why is that important? And the kid was like, ah! It'd be like a second grade class. The kid was like, it's important because we should learn, because we shouldn't behave in school. And she's like, no. And she would determine that like the teacher hadn't done their job because they should know what they're learning and why. But that was really for more experienced teachers, like once you have 5+ years. When you're a new teacher, they should really just know what they're learning. It's an added bonus if they know why. This is just part of being an over planner. What I would recommend that you do is just is actually practice your lesson and build in like a certain amount of minutes for each section and practice it and make sure that it's actually that many minutes. So if your introduction is supposed to be 5 minutes and they're playing the game for 20 minutes, time that introduction 3 times until you really have it at 5 minutes. Because otherwise you're going to talk and talk and talk and talk, and then the time's going to be up. Make sense? So this, let's look at this question. This is about breaking it down and making it simple. I really think you should do this for something, for one of your lessons that you have in mind. Or maybe a lesson that you've seen. Otherwise, I just don't think it's going to be helpful to you. So think about either something that you've taught or something that you plan on teaching or something that you've seen taught, and just think about how you could make it even more simple to make it 30 minutes. Ideas for shortening or making a lesson more simple?
Like, so my lesson has like a bunch of like questions and talking and a warm-up and sometimes 2 or 3 activities. Maybe like shorten and cut out 1 activity,
mm-hmm.
or like shorten the warm-up 1 minute, talk a little bit less, so that cuts out a few more minutes.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Anything else?
Cutting out some routines would be awesome.
Like what?
Let's say I was talking like football lesson. So we have these flag football belts,
mm-hmm.
and we usually just before any activity, just so they get be familiar with it, prep on every time. Could cut that out, save some time.
Do you need the belts for to actually do the activity though?
Not in the beginning activities, like
okay.
Say like throwing, catching, or else.
Mm-hmm.
It's more for like the actual game, and then just so they can get familiar with it. So
mm-hmm.
they come, just, they put on right away.
That's like a tough one, because I almost think, I worry if that's younger students, you might not want to cut that out. Because otherwise, when it comes time to play the game, and you get, yeah, it takes them forever, and then they forgot what they're supposed to be doing. Because they're all, so that might be one that you might want to keep if they're younger. But you could, I would, to make it shorter, I would model it and then have like 2 kids, so they're seeing it a bunch of times, and that way that's not like mayhem when they're all trying to help each other out. Any other ideas? This is the most important thing that you can do when you have a demo lesson. And it's also, I'm not kidding, 70% of teachers don't do this. And every time I'm like shocked, I can't believe it. I don't know why. I don't know why they don't do this, but they don't. Set expectations before you start your lesson. Hi, my name is Miss Willingham. I'm going to be joining you today for 30 minutes. These are my expectations. 1, 2, 3. Make it quick. You don't have to go into too much detail, but make sure that you do it. Why?
So you don't lose them even before you start.
Mm-hmm. What else?
It is too much, they forget.
Mm-hmm.
So when you remind them that they're withdrawing, we had a start point. So you just remind them of the start point and, you know, point out the behavior that is not in alignment with the expectations, and they'll know that you're not playing.
Mm-hmm. And they need to know that, because they will try it. I swear, they
mm-hmm.
will try it.
Every time.
Every time, even if you think you're a guest teacher and you're like, they'll show me respect, the principal's right in the back of the room. No, I've seen horrible things happen. Just be ready for it. But here's the thing, here's the number one reason why you need to set expectations right away. Okay, basically, administrators that are in the back of the room, yes, they're watching to see if you're a solid educator. Yes, they're watching to see if you're, you know, if you're objective driven, right, the number one thing that they're watching for is what is classroom management, is whether you can keep these kids safe. They're not going to hire a liability, right? So if you get up there and it comes time to get everyone's attention and you're like, and they're like, and they just run around. They're looking at you. Sorry, that was really ridiculous looking. They're looking at you and they're thinking, she cannot keep them safe. Why would I hire her? Right? It's a liability. Like, if they're never going to hire somebody who can't keep the kids safe. So right away, first and foremost, you want to make sure that you can keep them safe. And if you teach them, if you say, I want you to raise your hands, and they don't raise their hands, follow up. I call on raised hands, right? If your attention signal is that dumb clap, I can't think of another one right now. You could also do, sorry, I did it forever. You could also do, if you hear me clap once, right? If you hear me clap twice, that's actually my favorite. But if that's your expectation and they're not doing it, stop, shut it down, and explain to them, I'm here, this is what I'm doing. Do it in a nice way, but shut it down. Otherwise, they're going to see that you can't keep the kids safe and they're not getting the job, I promise. Okay. Brief, don't get too much into detail. Have a pre-prepared, I always recommend, have a little chart that you just bring with you, and just have like three expectations on it. And bring it with you. If you try to enlist their help, and if you try to ask them, oh, what are the rules, you know, that we have in here, it's not going to go well. Because they're going to start asking questions, they're going to disagree, it's going to take too long, you only have 30 minutes. Have your three expectations, and just tell them what they are. Try to also, this is what I recommend, raise your hand, attention signal, listen to the speaker. Maybe keep your hands to yourself. What's another rule that you might have? I feel like it's a little bit different because there's a lot of activity with what you guys do.
And the whistle blows, you freeze.
Right. It's an intentional signal. And the whistle blows, you freeze. You could also do like something about safe bodies, maybe, since they're going to be running around and possibly bumping into each other, maybe on purpose, maybe not. Make it interactive if you can. I said with younger students, younger really means like eighth grade or below. So if you're, what I mean by make it interactive, I'm not saying like, show me how you raise your hand, boys and girls. I'm just saying like, watch, when I clap, you clap. Let's try it. And then, right? So just, that's what I mean by make it interactive. No, I meant for you to do it. It's okay. If you're going to do like, if it's younger students and you're asking them to raise their hand, you might want to say, show me how you raise your hand. Good, 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 good. You're raising your hand. And just keep them displayed. Whatever they should be doing, whatever the directions are for the game that you're teaching them, I don't know if this is something that you've done before, have it written out and have it so that they can see it. That way if they get confused, they can always look, they don't have to ask you. Think of how annoying it is when everybody's playing a game and they're like running up to you and they're like, he said that the red team was supposed to just point to the chart. It's a huge, that's gonna be huge for you. Also, okay, setting expectations. This is huge. Think about what expectations you're going to have when you do your demo lesson. If you already thought about it when the whistle blows freeze, boom, that's number one. But they should be different for everybody. So think about what your expectations are, 3 to 5 of them. Okay, who's got a good one? Or you can read all three of them for fun, so make your own brave.
I was gonna say, you're responsible for your actions and everyone else's actions.
Good. What else? Something about an attention signal. Everybody should have something about an attention signal. Cause if you can't, if the students aren't responding to an attention signal, you're not gonna get the job, right? What else?
Like, we were talking about music, like a lot of us play music in the gym.
Mm-hmm.
When music stops, everyone stops.
Good. Perfect.
This is piggybacking on that. When music stops, everyone sits down.
Oh, okay, even
yeah.
better.
Thanks.
Yeah.
When it whistles blowing, you freeze.
Okay.
Keep all equipments, put down all equipments.
Like take care of the equipment might be a good one for you, if you're using equipment.
No, you try to put it down, because they will bounce the ball a while.
You mean when it's time to?
No, like if we blow the whistle, they
oh.
will continue to bounce the ball.
Okay.
Like,
so like when the whistle blows, hands-free freeze, something like that.
Need a sports one.
Good, that's a good one, that's a really good one. I would actually suggest that most of you do that, because you're going to find that you have problems otherwise. Anything else? If there's materials, or if they're working in groups, so maybe something about being kind or sharing, if it's younger kids. Taking your turn. Playing by the rules. Any, did we miss any? Okay, so here's what you're going to do. Hopefully this does not happen, but in case it does, and I've seen many, all right, so let me just start by saying this. I've seen lots of lessons where disaster, something really bad happens. Not some, you know, nobody like gets horribly hurt or anything like that, but where the lesson doesn't go the way that the teacher wanted it to at all. What matters, and this might happen to you, what matters is the way that you respond to it. They know that you're new teachers. They're gonna be pretty forgiving. Right? So if your lesson is garbage, you can still get the job. They're not expecting it to be great. I promise you, I was a terrible teacher when I started teaching. And anyone that says that they were good when they started, they're either lying or they're lying. There's no other option. You're not a good teacher when you first start, I promise. But what matters is how you respond to it. Like how you go back the next day and you try something new, right? How you get better and better. So that's what they're looking for. They're looking to see that you're reflective about the mistakes that you made and that you notice the mistakes that you made. That's a huge one. So when students are acting up, when students are not following directions, warm stretch, what does that mean? It's obvious.
Tone of voice?
Yes. So you can be firm with them. Just don't be rude. You don't want to scream at them, right? You don't want to be condescending.
Seal it with a smile.
Yeah. Exactly. Say it with a smile if you need to. Just show them that you're in charge. You can even do like a silent correction. Just go over and whisper if you can. Make a group correction. But just try not to be, don't be too nice about it. And try not to be too firm about it. Nobody wants to see the kids get yelled at. Who's seen Kindergarten Cop?
I saw the rug. I was like, oh, that's great.
Yes. You're closer to my generation. So Kindergarten Cop is Arnold Schwarzenegger as a kindergarten. I just highly suggest, if you have not seen it, it's
great movie.
Arnold Schwarzenegger as a kindergarten teacher is ridiculous. It's the most ridiculous movie. But this is like him teaching kindergarten and the kids are running around screaming. And he's like, wah! And he's screaming in the middle of the room. It's ridiculous. But that's the way that you're going to feel if you haven't already felt this way. You're going to have at least one Kindergarten Cop moment, I promise you. So when that happens, and the kids are not doing what they're supposed to be doing, you feel it like the blood is rising, you feel like you're losing your mind, it's fine. They're not looking to see that, like, they're not looking for perfection. What they're looking to see is that you stop, and you bring everybody back, and you say, no, that's not what we're doing. Let's rewind. Let's go over the rules. Then you have your chart. You're like, number one, we're supposed to be with a partner. Are you with a partner, for example? So the point is that you notice it, that it's a mess, and you stop and you get everyone back together and you reset the expectations. That's what's most important. If you think, because I've seen teachers do this, they think that the leadership doesn't notice, and they're just walking around there like this, just like watching students. None of the kids are doing what they're supposed to be doing, and they don't want to address it because they think the principal doesn't notice. The principal notices, I promise. You gotta handle it, okay? Promise me that you're gonna handle it.
I promise.
Good. All right, I like it. And if all else fails, lesson is a hot mess, didn't go the way that you wanted it to, they didn't even finish what they were supposed to be doing, half of the kids didn't even understand the game, right? They're all arguing with each other. Just think of your worst possible nightmare, okay? If that happens, you can still save it. You can still get the job, which sounds insane, but you can. The way that you can still save it is during that debrief. Do you know what a debrief is? Okay, do you want to explain it?
Debrief is basically at the end of the lesson, you go over things that the lesson was about.
Right.
And you go over like the cues, the lesson goals, and then you reflect on. You basically bring up, I guess, like, why didn't we accomplish everything today,
mm-hmm.
or
why did we,
yeah,
or whatever it is.
Yeah.
Right. So that you can do that with students, but you can also do that afterwards with the leadership team. So after you finish your lesson, right, and you're gathering up all of your materials, and you're like, oh, thank God, it's over, I can go home, right, and relax, it's not done yet. You go into an office, usually, with the leadership team, whoever came and watched your lesson, and you debrief how the lesson went, basically. And that's when you can still save it. And that's also where you can mess it up, and I'll tell you how. So, the debrief. Can't finish. So you can do this, or you can do this.
Mm-hmm.
This is what you're gonna be doing on the inside, okay? This is inside, this is outside, inside, outside, inside, outside. So you're gonna be so annoyed because you're gonna be sitting there and they're gonna tell you what you did wrong. They're gonna tell you how you could have done it differently. And you don't want to hear that. Nobody, do you want to hear what you did wrong? I don't. I definitely don't. But this is what you need to be doing on the outside. Why?
Because you want to be a best representation of yourself. You don't want your ego to drive. You want you to drive.
Yes, ego is a good word.
You want to show that you acknowledge your mistake and you're willing to learn.
Same thing? That's exactly. Think about if you were a principal. Like, who do you want working for you? Do you want someone sitting there being like, no, no, that's not true. No, my lesson was perfect. Or do you want somebody who's like, that's interesting. Yeah, I'll work on that. You want somebody who wants to get better and who's easy to work with. So here's what you should do. Here's what you shouldn't do. Don't be defensive. You're going to want to be defensive. You're going to want to say things like, but I didn't even know the kids, or but I didn't know that kid had an IEP, or but I didn't know, we only had 30 minutes. Don't do it. Every single person that comes in for a demo lesson has the same limitations. These are out of order. Don't show appreciation for the feedback. So that you can even say thank you. That's interesting. Thank you. Okay. Yeah, I didn't think of that. Thank you, sir. May I have another? That type of thing. This is a bonus. So if you have that clipboard and you have the kids and you had some notes about what the kids were doing, use that. So when they ask you questions like, how do you think, what percentage of students do you think mastered the objective? You can actually look on the clipboard or you can look through your notes and say, well, it looks like about 6 of them had no idea how to play the game. That was interesting. I thought they were paying attention. They weren't. Maybe 10 of them played it like, you know, did an okay job, and then 9 of them excelled. That alone is way above what most teachers do during a demo lesson. So have some kind of data to look at. Also, just be prepared. I should have said this right in the beginning. The first thing that 90% of the time what they're going to ask you, right when you sit down for the debrief, they're going to say, so how do you think it went? That's going to be the first thing that they say. So you want to tell them, you probably have 5 minutes to reflect, you want to tell them immediately what are the things that you would do differently. But also what went well. Don't guess, don't think and say, I think the kids, don't be vague. I think they did pretty well. I think they liked it. Those are all just subjective things to say. They want to see that you're actually using data and you're actually thoughtful about whether or not students are learning. Has anybody had the pleasure of having feedback from somebody on their lesson? How did it go?
I was supervising.
Yeah, you all should have already.
Yeah. Did anybody get some feedback that was really hard to take? Be honest, I know she's right here. I did. I'm just telling you this because maybe you had a similar experience, maybe you didn't. When I had my first student teaching observation, I was so dramatic about it. She came in and she told me like 5 things that I did wrong. I thought that I was like changing students' lives and was gonna be the greatest teacher in the history of the world. Like I thought it was like a mic drop situation. And she was like, no. Like you did she told me all the things I did wrong, and I went home and I was like, maybe I don't want to be a teacher. Like, maybe this isn't for me. And the whole winter break, I spent, like, crying and being dramatic and thinking that I wasn't going to be a good teacher. And then I was a good teacher. But I wasn't at first. And then I was. It just took a while. So my point is, be receptive to the feedback. Everything she told me was true. Every single thing that she told me was 100% accurate. Just lose the ego and just know that you're not going to be that good yet. I promise you. But you will be okay. Maybe even like halfway decent by year 2, year 3. If you try, you'll be great, I promise. So now it's Q&A. That was a little bit quick, that's good. You guys have a nice long break. Questions? It's a Wednesday. Anything about demos, about interviews?
With the demo lesson, is it like standard now that you'll be, or is it like a school by school basis?
That's a good question. It's pretty standard. I've seen even with when there's like last minute hires in the summertime, like they'll find students somehow, and you think you can get out of it
yeah, they'll have you do it in summer school.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay, gotcha.
Which is actually not ideal because the kids do not want to be there.
Yeah.
It's pretty standard. Maybe private schools are less likely to do it, but not that much less likely to do it. It's pretty standard. Anything else?
What kind of questions should you expect during an interview?
Oh, that's a great question. There's a whole other workshop that I do that's interviewing 101. a lot questions about data. There's gonna be definitely questions about data. Accommodating the needs of lots of different students, 100% you will get a question like that. Students with disabilities, something about that. Maybe incorporating technology. I'm trying to think of for you because it's a little bit different. I was going to say something about maybe assessing for the objective.
I know, like, from the interviews I've seen, like, at my school and stuff, especially for PE positions, they ask a lot about what type of assessment are you going to take, especially because you're in a gymnasium. What are you going to be doing while the kids are actively playing? They want to know, are you actively monitoring them?
Mm-hmm.
How are you assessing them? How are you keeping that data? And then they also want to know about differentiation that you're doing. You're going to have various learners, whether or not it's physical disabilities they may have, or it's just skill-based. How are you going to meet the needs of all those different types of learners in that setting? So you have to come prepared and think about,
mm-hmm.
what are you going to do? Are you modifying equipment? Or are you just modifying activities?
Mm-hmm. Anything else? Same applies for the interview, by the way. Is a receptive, interested, open to feedback. Couple quick things for interview. If you aren't sure whether you answered a question, just ask them. Just say, did I answer your question? I've seen teachers do that, and it's great. It's showing that you're like, you want to make sure that you're addressing their question. Make sure that you're positive. Don't ever say anything bad about any school that you ever taught at. It just makes you look, it's not a good look. And teachers do that a lot. They're like, well, my administration wasn't very supportive. Don't do that. It's just a bad look. But yeah, that's about it. Those are the quick ones. Anything else?